Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Listen, I know it's a room full of intelligent people, but we need to wake up a little bit. My name is seangarrison, a local Minneapolis artist, more or less abstract work. Did the work behind us. And the plan was to come up here and do a spoken word piece, because I write as well. But I'm going to talk of a different type of art, right? And as an art, and it ties into what we're talking about, this art of being a black man in America, right? Or just an African American in general in America. Because I tell folks that we have to recreate ourselves every day in these different spaces. It's an art to have to walk into a space and walk differently, talk differently, almost dance differently. It's a beauty in that. It's a beauty for me to be able to translate what I go through throughout a day, throughout a minute, dealing with some of this on canvas. We are in a, and we'll talk about this also, but I want to really kind of address this because no one's really mentioned it, especially when I was out here, is that we're in an epicenter of this new movement, right? And I found it interesting that no one asked what that experience was like in 2020 in Minneapolis. Because there was an art in dealing with that as well. Generally what I do visually is that I've kind of ceased to a degree of painting things that look good over a couch or on the clinic wall, unless the contract come in and they say, here it is, oh, that looks good, I need to keep the lights on, right? But a lot of my work now is all social issue focused, something to bring light to what's going on, things that we need to do, so on and so forth. And I can talk about more about that later. But in a nutshell, that's me. I've been known to talk long, so I'm gonna stop while I'm ahead. But I appreciate y'all for showing up and showing out. And as we say in the neighborhood, let's do this.
I will pull a few pieces, a couple of pieces from my bag. I am not really known to be an artist, but I was asked to, since this particular session in part is about art, I pulled out a few pieces that I actually made for one or another of my daughters in California, and they dropped. And so when I was visiting there about a month ago, I said, let me take those home now and repair them. And so first of all, I'll show you this, and you may see where the drop here took away one of the legs. But this is a crocodile. And what's important about a crocodile is that although it lives in water, it breathes air. It lives in water, but it breathes air. And this is associated with a Akan proverb. And so you might think about what that means in your life. When I thought about that in relationship to those of us here, I thought about the pervasive racism that is the water of the context that we are in. And we may be living in water, but we are required to find the air so that we can breathe the air and recreate an environment of air. The other piece, this piece I maybe did about 15 years ago. Since I'm not an artist, I have not continued with my work in recent years, but now I hope to have more time for it. The other piece I did while at seminary on a project, and you may know that A few generations ago, many African men, especially in the South, took the name of Amos. Remember even the Amos and Andy show? I mean, Amos was a very common name for a black man. Well, why? Why? Amos was all about justice. He stood up to authority, the authorities of his time in northern Israel. And his life was, he was chased out of that area because of his outspoken words concerning oppression. And so Amos was the person that I chose to do a project on. And this is made of ebony wood, the wood of my ancestry. It also has cocobolo, some of the red that you see here. And this is from the Americas. So it joins two ancestries, two peoples, two worlds together. So thank you.
I am from clay earth, straw walls, and sweat beads dripping from sun-kissed bronze skin. Descendant of freedom fighters resisting the Qin dynasty's attempt to unify all of China. Refugees escaping to Southeast Asia, strategically situating mountainside to defend our children and our elders. I am from the pressure point of having to choose between two evils, being used as shields to defend American soldiers or accepting being second-class citizens. I am from bullets flying, white allies, babies drowning, and more than 50% of Hmong men sacrificed. I am from heroes, blia, go, va, Hmong leaders labeled terrorists for siding with Americans persecuted, Hmong diaspora, metal wings that flew me to white snow. I am from McDonough Homes, West Side, St. Paul, Oakdale, North Minneapolis. I am from Central Senior High School, spoken word. From doing for others before doing for yourself. Fighting sexism in the Hmong community while fighting racism in the larger community. Grappling with internalized racism, learning to love myself, choosing to change for the better. I am from the strong scent of incense early Saturday mornings. From ancestors that found the courage to scream when silence was expected. Finding power in failure, learning to lose to win, choosing courage rather than fear. I am from the silver lining, the strength that develops in driftwood. Fighters, survivors, thrivers. I am from clay, earth, and concrete sidewalks. I am from unshaken hope, undeniable courage, and the strength to keep fighting. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. Before we jump into the conversation that's going to be incredibly rich, I would like to talk a little bit about the land that we are on. Truth and acknowledgement are critical to building mutual respect and connection across all barriers of heritage and difference. We begin this effort to acknowledge that what has been buried by honoring the truth. Today, the APA Convention is on Dakota and Anishinaabe land. And we honor the elders of today and the elders of before that have taken care of this land. I say this acknowledgement so that we can really keep in mind the trauma and the history that informs where we are today. We pay respect to the elders And we also acknowledge the unpaid labor and forced servitude of enslaved African Americans, their descendants, whose unremitted labor and exploitation was pivotal to the rapid economic growth of this nation and face ongoing oppression, racism, and violence. I would be remiss if I did not also acknowledge those of Asian descent who were among those who took on the task of building the transcontinental railroad connecting the East and the West together, only to be silenced. Unacknowledged contributions to this world, to this country. We recognize the broken promises and harms done to the first peoples of these lands, the horrors of American slavery, the betrayal of Hispanic Americans, and the silencing of Asian Americans, acknowledging the painful legacies of inequity that continues to persist. My name is Dr. Talee Vang. I am a psychologist that is local from Minneapolis. I'm the director of health equity and education at Hennepin Healthcare, a hospital that is a few blocks away from here. And I am so excited to be here to talk a little bit about the city of Minneapolis. The city of Minneapolis and what we have been going through, right? We have been the epicenter, as mentioned by Sean. And when George Floyd was murdered, it shook the world. It came upon the heels of the murder of others like Philando Castillo, like Jamal Clark, Fong Lee, Jason Yang, and didn't stop there because we also know of Amir Locke. When communal trauma, collective trauma occurs, what is potentially there for us is this idea that we know to be post-traumatic growth. So let's talk a little bit today about that. I'd like to introduce to you all my guests. Now, I'd like to introduce you all to Sean Garrison first. Sean Garrison is an artist in residence in Minneapolis, in the Minneapolis African American Heritage Museum and Gallery, and uses his work to activate emotions in people to affect change. Dr. Okogyeamon is the founding member of Facilitating Racial Equity Collaborative, whose organization seeks to build just, equitable, and anti-racist communities throughout Minnesota. Okogyeamon helped to found the collaborative in 2004. So let's go ahead and give them a warm welcome. Now, I'd like to ask you a question. I'm gonna first ask you, Okogyeamon, if you can maybe tell me a little bit about yourself, the work that you do and how you have been engaging in anti-racist work.
Yes, thank you. I first want to acknowledge the very beautiful historical overview that you provided us with, both locally and the legacy that we all have and need to acknowledge. So thank you very much for that. I often introduce myself as a Californian because that's always very important to me. It situates me in a certain history. Born in Seattle, worked in the vineyards and the farm labor work in Seattle when I was a child, among Latinos and Filipinos and whites and blacks, and especially the Native American folk of the Yakima people. So that's really a big imprint. And then being raised after leaving Seattle at five, coming to South Central Los Angeles, and then to Compton Wilbrook Watts, that definitely stamped me in terms of my identity, in terms of who I am and how I relate to the world as a lower working class person who received a very good education and was then able to go into Ivy League schools. And so I have this particular background as well as a background living in Bangladesh, and all of that has been central to my identity and travels in Africa, central to my identity, and my art represents that. That's why, you know, my art looks that way, because that's my orientation. And all of this life work brought me into the anti-racism work. So I was living the aspect of what does it mean to be in a multicultural world and experiencing racism in the 1940s and 50s and 60s. I gave myself a haircut the other day. Otherwise, I'd still look like 50, but actually I'm 84. So I say that in terms of I have experienced all of that and the worst of it. And if anyone knows Los Angeles, especially in that period, a very racist area. And so all of that was part of my learning, part of who I am. And so I went into ethnic studies as a college teacher, intercultural studies, and now at this time, working with FREC, organizing committees to bring anti-racism understandings to the region, all of Minnesota and people coming in from other areas nearby, and also in my own particular organization, Anti-Racism Study Dialogue Circles, doing dialogue circles with organizations, with community people, activists, teaching classes, teaching classes in that area. So this work has been very much a part of my life, and I'm really happy to be with you to be in this conversation.
Now, Okogyeamon, can you help explain to us what your name means? Because you told me the story, and it was a beautiful, beautiful meaning. I'd like for you to share that.
Yes, thank you. So, as I said, very early on, I developed a Afrocentric consciousness, and that was through my grandmother, who was a daughter of slave parents. So, very early on, consciousness. I wanted to have an African name. I wanted to be identified with the continent of my ancestry. And so, when I received a Fulbright a scholarship to study the history and art and literature, culture of Ghana, the first day there in this month's period, essentially, I told one of my Ghanaian mentors that I wish to receive an African name. And he said, well, it's not that easy. You know, you just don't kind of pull a name off a shelf. And he said, no, it's not like that. We have to know you, and you have to really have a sense of who you are. You have to be brought into a family relationship. It's the family who gives the name. And so after this month-long period of traveling throughout Ghana and engaging in many different conversations with the lecturers from the universities of Ghana, there were three universities there, he said, okay, we have the name, it's Okogyeamon. And he said that means he who awakens a village in danger. And this conjures up, it's a young man who had that responsibility. During the night, the village is sleeping, they would take responsibility for whatever happened. And if something should happen that needed to be addressed, whatever it was, then they would waken the village to the danger.
So inspirational. Thank you for sharing that. Yes. Sean, can you tell us a little bit about yourself, the work that you do, and how you've been engaging in anti-racism work?
Thank you. First off, I wish I had a cool name like Okogyeamon.
We'll go to Ghana together.
Oh, we're going to have to, brother. So I'm like, wow, I'm just Sean. That's okay. And like yourself, I guess I need to state, I'm from Detroit. Any Michiganders in here? Okay, what's happening, y'all? Been here for a while, raised in Minneapolis. Just to start with this whole art piece, so I've been writing for about 37 years. Picked up a paintbrush about 11, 12 years ago, and virtually self-taught myself. And as that relates to, you know, any racist work, it's you know, I figure I was born, my birth was anti-racist, mm-hmm. right? Being born amongst this, even though it has its good moments, mm-hmm. we know the reality that we're in. You know, typically when I do, because I do a lot of live performances, interpretive work, typically leading into those shows, I give the audience a dose of reality for me. And that reality is that just based on who I am and my space in this country, you know, I might not wake up tomorrow. I might not be able to make it through tomorrow. And that's just the reality of things mm. as a black man in America, right? And so, so I give people that understanding that my black joy keeps me going. That's anti-racist to me. Mm-hmm. Yes. Right, because it doesn't control how I move and why I move, mm-hmm. nor does it dictate the pace at which I move. I just know that I need to keep moving because there are too many things that I feel as an artist that I need to do. Mm-hmm. I guess the most, for the academic term, anti-racist thing that I've actually is forthcoming now is a show I'm doing next month. It's called The Darkness in My Skin, and it's where I'll be painting a mass lynching and connecting that with today over an hour-long performance. Mm-hmm. So it'll be 15 hanging bodies, it's abstract, you know, for an hour and a half. And then after that, with myself and the audience, we'll have this long conversation mm-hmm. about where do we go from this point forward? Mm-hmm. Because it's my take that we've been having too many of the same conversations, which is why we're still having these conversations, mm-hmm. right? We've been having these conversations since, at least as it pertains to enslaved Africans, since 1619. Mm-hmm. We're 403 years later still having the same conversation, which tells me we're not mm-hmm. really brave enough to heal as a country. And so the show is really digging at the roots of this American tree and not just whacking at the leaves. Mm-hmm. You know, which I think a lot of us do too often. So I've been committed to that, mm-hmm. you know, because I do believe in the human spirit. I do believe that the majority of people are good people and want to see better, want to do better. But it's just a matter of who's going to be brave enough and courageous enough and full-throated enough to say, this is what we're going to do and this is not negotiable. I also took it when I assumed the title of artist. It took me 3 years to say I was an artist. That's an obligation to me. It comes a responsibility, like anyone that has a platform, right? We can't use it just to say cool stuff or paint pretty pictures and not to use it to edify humanity. So with all of this, mm-hmm. That's the basis of this. This artwork was born out of a live show I did last year that spoke about the whole George Floyd experience. And I'll leave it at that because I can talk forever, but
You said something that I thought was incredibly, well, you said many, many things that were incredibly powerful, but even your being born is an act of anti-racism, and that really, really hit with me. You mentioned something about your artwork and your next big show is gonna be about a lynching. I have to ask, is art therapeutic, cathartic for you? And how do you make amends with the history? And what do you hope to bring for your audience? Going into a space where you described having bodies hanging, that's intense.
Very much so. Where do I start with this? So I'll start with the show. The intent of the show is to push people. Well, let me back up. So someone asked, why are you doing a show with a bunch of hanging bodies? Aren't you going to, you know, aren't you feel you're going to re-traumatize people? Mm. And I tell them, I said that if my understanding of English, that the English language is accurate, to re-traumatize someone means that they're already beyond the first trauma. That's the way I see it. And I tell them, no one in this room is beyond the first trauma. So I don't think I can re-traumatize anyone. I can re-energize and awaken some things inside of you haven't noticed before, but we're walking bodies of trauma, right? And so the point of this show, with that being said, is to really get the audience in the space of what I consider the most beautiful emotion within humans, and that's pain.
Yeah.
Because that's an honest space that we're in. You know, I've been told someone has loved me 50 million times and probably been lied to 49 million times, right? That's a joke, it's been about 50. But but the space of pain, we can't be, it's hard to be dishonest in that space.
Mm-hmm.
And so to get us in this space where tears, of course, would be flowing and so on and so forth, then we can have this conversation that because we're brave enough to get through this moment.
Mm-hmm.
We're brave enough to get through this hour and a half and spend this time together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, and again, seeing all that I've seen, I haven't been blessed to hit 84 yet, but seeing what I've seen over these 50 years, I do know the conversation we're having haven't been enough.
You know, that brings me to my second question. And Sean, I'd like to pose this question to you first. So after the murder of George Floyd, our community members took to the streets to demand for justice. There was a national outcry. And really, people wanted accountability, like true accountability, by organizations, by institutions. Systemically, there was a need, and there is a need for things to change. So as it relates to post-traumatic growth, I talked a little bit about that today. How do you think turning tragedy into triumph, perhaps? What do you think that psychologists can do? What do you think organizations can do to dismantle racism and racist systems that they operate in?
I think the first thing psychologists should do, need to do, and everyone else for that matter, is to start with honesty and to start with truth. Don't start with the theory, start with the reason why this thing has even been researched. Go all the way back again to the roots of how this thing started.
Mm.
Because again, you know, speaking of the George Floyd murder, we talk about the Derek Chauvins of the world, but we don't truly talk about how he became, you know. So I consider him like a leaf. I consider Peyton Gendron in Buffalo a leaf. You know, those leaves fall and die and they fall off and more leaves grow. And we talk about that ad nauseum until the energy dissipates and then we wait for the next one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Peyton Gendron was Dylan Roof years ago,
mm-hmm.
right? But we didn't say, okay, how did this dude truly become? And that goes all the way back to the inception of this country.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of folks don't want to address that.
Mm-hmm.
And don't want to truly, okay, how do we really pull this up so we can stop having this conversation that a lot of people say they're tired of?
That reminds me of this saying, right, that racism is kind of like the heads of Hydra. Mm-hmm. And so when you cut one head, it comes up two and three and multiplies. And what you're saying is get it at the heart, mm-hmm. right? Kill it Definitely. At the base or
Definitely.
Foundation.
Definitely.
Okogyeamon, what do you think? What do you think psychologists can do, organizations, to truly dismantle racism in the systems that we operate in?
Well, one thing that Sean said that I very much agree with in my own response to this is honesty. And what does that mean? That means trying to look at the things, first of all, that we are turning away from. So this introspection. So why am I turning away from that? One aspect of racism is avoidance, experience avoidance. What experiences am I avoiding? Why is it that when I might turn to an African-American male in particular, because this is where it's particularly strong, or to a black person or a brown person, oftentimes we turn away, we avert our eyes. What is that all about? What's that experience avoidance all about? Where is that coming from? So what I'm saying is a quest to understand where our stuff is coming from. Can we start looking at ourselves seriously and taking note of that? What are my behaviors? Why am I responding in this way? Why is my heart beating faster now? Why am I choosing to sit here? You know, why the black kids, all the black kids sitting together at the cafeteria kind of thing. Why am I choosing, and I've seen this at anti-racism workshops. I've seen the same thing happen. So why am I engaging in this kind of behavior? And then we start looking at trying to understand the background of our implicit biases. Where is that coming from? So we start looking at our socialization, in the context of our socialization, the in-group and out-group formations that were part of our early socialization that really had nothing to do with our choices. Who is around us? Who do I feel safe with? Who can I have a conversation with? Who can I show some intimacy with? And how has that then conditioned me? So we start looking at our own conditioning, implicit biases, even our sense of what it means to be BIPOC, black or indigenous, Latino, Hispanic, Hmong, Chinese, Japanese, whatever it might be, looking at that, Irish, Russian, Ethiopian, whatever it might be, start looking at trying to understand, for example, what does it mean to be white? And consciously looking at the costs of that, costs in terms of relationships, cost in terms of a false sense of self, or maybe, you know, at least begin this sense of self that I have. Is it really something that, why do I have this sense of privilege that will start showing itself in different ways, acknowledging the ways that we are acting out our privilege in ways that we talk, the interactions that we engage in. And so looking at some of these things that are coming from our socialization, looking at then whiteness, doing some reading on that, doing some study on that. Who are the friends and whatnot, our friendship networks that are contributing to really strengthening that whiteness? And so getting out of that is, how do I then, first of all, start understanding myself, exposing myself to experiences that I've not had, and do some serious reading? I brought with me a book that I am reading right now that I'm finding very informative, and it's Eliminating Race-Based Healthcare Disparities, Promoting Equity and Culturally Responsive Care Across Settings. And so this is within the kind of reading that you would do in APA. And so this is something, it also has a lot of information exactly on what can be done to bring about transformation, but especially a self-understanding.
Thank you so much for, excuse me, thank you so much for bringing that and sharing that. I haven't read that and I will definitely be reading that. Two things really stood out to me from both of your answers. That is honesty, truth, or three things, history, right? And being honest about our history is really what I kind of put together. What is difficult that I think it's important for us to really name is that for so many ethnically diverse communities in the United States, our histories have been erased intentionally, right? Because the erasure of history is a tool of colonizers. And so it's really, how do we rediscover that? How do we talk about that? And this is not only the history of Black African Americans in this country and really being able to understand where is my family lineage or American Indians, their history and how they trace, right, some of the historical losses and other races in this country. White people too. The history in this country has been shielded, covered. And now we all know, right, as we're continuing to talk about this, there's a movement to really stop the conversation. So I'm curious about if either of you have thoughts on that. I don't know who would like to go first with this one.
Well, in regard to stopping the conversation, we dare not seriously engage in that conversation and still be able to continue racism. Racism depends upon maintaining the structures as they are and not questioning those structures, not questioning the ideas, the rationale that holds those structures together. Once we start examining that and understanding that, then racism is having a problem. Mm-hmm. There was more to your question than I think I may have missed part of that.
The erasure of history, how do we make amends with that?
Well, I think for me, the very simple response would be that we start looking at the histories, not only our own history, but those people of color in particular who are near to us, such as in this area, understanding indigenous history, among the Asian experiences, the Hmong experience. So, you know, what is your location? What is the historical knowledge that you need to understand in order to be able to form relationships, to orient yourself to others who are in your immediate location and context? That's where I would start. I would start with what's near, understanding the plights, the issues that they are dealing with, the kind of the economics that they have to contend with, the politics that are important to them, and allying ourselves with them. You can't create alliances and coalitions working collaboratively unless you begin to know people where they're coming from.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
First of all, you said erase your history. I think that only happens if we allow that to happen.
Mm. Same.
Right? We know that, I mean, it's gotten better, of course, since I was in school, that the history of all the peoples in this country aren't taught in these schools. And so when I used to work at a middle school, actually with the district here, I'm sorry, for about 10 or 12 years, and I used to tell parents that they're only gonna get 20% of who they are and they're learning within these walls. Mm-hmm. You have to do the rest. So the erasure happens if we allow the system to continue to hold the pencil, so to say, right? We have to take control of that and say, this is the education we need to give our people and our youth about who we are, mm-hmm. Right, in order to keep us going. Because they always say, you don't know where you're coming from, you don't know where you're going, which is why we see what we see. Mm-hmm. But as far as getting the people to come together, that's a matter of being willing to be able to sit down and not look at each other as the other and not fall in this trick bag that this country has gotten us into and say, okay, what are you about? What's going on? And really share these stories, because if we look at the stories in total, They intersect quite a bit. But, you know, then we go back to the whole divide and conquer thing. You have to keep us divided.
That's right.
To keep us blind to what's really going on, you know. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned colonizers, and that's, you know, this stuff predates young America, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So this is what we're dealing with here is just a child of what's been going on in, yes. across the world for thousands of years. So it's a matter of truly just sitting down and saying, hey, this is what's going on, and be brave enough to get through that, and being able to call it for what it is. We know this is what it is, mm-hmm. and not being scared to call it for what it is.
So let me ask you then the next question, because it's actually really, really well tied in. So George Floyd's murder occurred during the beginning of the pandemic, May 2020. That was also where we were experiencing a lot of anti-Asian hate. So we had those two things going on. Another tool, right, of colonizing is kind of pitting teams or groups against each other, divide and conquer, mm-hmm. to your point. Pitting groups against each other. What are ways that you think communities of color can support one another and resist that, right? Resist that, you know, kind of going for scraps, being told that we need to fight for what we are allowed to have.
We just need to show up for each other. It's really as simple as that. I tell people, you can't care from the couch. You know, get up and do something. Mm-hmm. You know, show up for each other.
Was that a dig on psychologists?
No, actually, you know what? No, it was not. But that's, okay. I've been saying that for years, but that's a good point. But no, it was not a dig, so don't be looking for me outside. I love you all, trust me. But I say that, I started that statement. because I know a lot of people who do a whole lot of talking, and they refuse to do a whole lot of walking. I'm like, I hear you talking, but I don't see you in the streets saying anything, you know. And so I said, you can't care from the couch. That's the genesis of that statement. But we truly have to show up for each other, you know, because, you know, again, oppression, racism doesn't stop at the, of course it doesn't stop at the doorstep of black folks in this country, right? Mm-hmm. We just happen to be like the poster child for it quite often. But we have to show up, and we have to understand that this is the thing. And since we know this is the thing, this thing is composed of many parts. And we all have to work in conjunction so this thing works efficiently. But it's not working efficiently because whoever runs the thing, we need to keep y'all, you know, backed up a little bit because, anyway, that's a whole nother 20-hour discussion. So,
Okogyeamon, do you have any thoughts?
Yes, show up for each other, definitely. And I also think promote each other. How do we promote each other? So I was introduced in regard to my work, my association with FREC, Facilitators for Equity, Racial Equity Collaborative. And one thing that has always been important for us in that organization, in our workshops, in our keynote speakers, in the performances that we have at the Overcoming Racism Conference that we've been having since 2008, is to promote each other in our very wide diversities, whether it's Native Americans, whether it's Hmong, whether it's Latino, whether it's African American, whether it is women, whatever. So we look at ourselves, we look at who is not here, whose voices need to be here, and we promote each other. One example, we have, in addition to the Overcoming Conference, we have monthly presentations. We also have a yearly institute, but at our monthly presentation, which anyone, wherever you're at, you can join, just go to the FREC website and you can find out where these conversations or when these conversations are taking place. But this one takes place, this what I'm speaking of now is a conversation. We're a learning community. FREC is a learning community. And so at this learning community event coming up on August the 19th, we have Selena Moon, who is a mixed Japanese America and independent scholar, who is giving a presentation on disability, especially associated with the Japanese. And so how do you find ways to promote each other, giving voice to each other, allowing people to speak from their own place, from their own experiences, rather than being spoken for? And so I would say, in addition to being there at our different events, also promoting.
Okay, coming together, promoting each other, really lifting each other up. I do think too that there have been traumas that have been perpetrated between communities of color, and I do think that there are important conversations of healing that can take place, and at the heart of it all, understanding that these traumas come from, so we're gonna go to what you're saying about the leaves in the tree and the base of the tree, the roots of the tree, is it's rooted in white supremacy. And so really kind of going for that, and you said earlier, Sean, name it. Don't be afraid to name it. In my opinion, I think it is white supremacy, this ideology that anybody can kind of adopt, right? That we've been kind of soaking in this country, but worldwide too. So thank you for that. My other question then, and Sean, I will direct this question to you first. How do you think we can stay consistent in this work? Like me, I'm sure many of you have seen things come and go. There's lots of intensity. There's a lot of momentum. Organizations are donating millions of dollars for this cause. All of a sudden, you see this movement. But once that event starts to plateau and die down, things start to lose steam. Resources get pulled away. How do we stay consistent in this work? Because, Sean, like to your point, we've been having these conversations for centuries.
I'm gonna try to make this quick, because that's yeah. You know, during the love rising here in Minneapolis in 2020, I don't call them rise, so I don't call them up risings. People rose up by the love for humanity,
yeah,
and for watching this snuff film in real time. In order for that energy not to dissipate, we have to have more intestinal fortitude to push this forward than the intestinal fortitude of those that want to just let it be, right? The reason why I think a lot of these conversations, and I've talked to a lot of people within organizations that say, when we have these tough conversations with people, they want to just be quiet and just exit from the conversation. Mm-hmm. Stop letting people exit from the conversation and allow them to work through the pain so that the light can shine through, as Rumi would say, right? Too often we get tired, you know, and go, well, so-and-so doesn't want to listen anymore, or the system doesn't want to listen anymore, so we'll just wait until the next thing. And then here we are again, repeating, you know, the same actions and same movements. So I think we have to be indefatigable in our movements and in our actions with this thing. Stay vigilant, you know, stay loud. Keep the figurative fires burning, you know, and don't let it die off, because if we do, then we'll be sitting here next time y'all in Minneapolis having the same conversation. Mm-hmm. So that's the way I see it.
Okay.
We cannot continue in this very difficult work without community. There's just no way. We need co-conspirators. We need a company. You can survive things if you have at least one, your psychologist, you know this, at least one person next to you, supporting you, keeping you going. Community is absolutely important. The work of FREC, we are all volunteers at representing different organizations, but as we've survived these 20 years creating the conference and doing this work that we couldn't be paid enough for. And we do this in community. We support each other. We have each other's backs. We're able to talk about the challenges and difficulties that come to us. We have this friend network of like-minded people engaged in the struggle. So the long haul, along that long journey, and this is a journey, you need a companion to talk to and to open up new ways of seeing and new ways of understanding, encouraging you to take the next step. You really need community. Mm.
Thank you so much. Before we wrap up, I'd like to ask both of you to share if there's one thing that you'd like for folks to know about Minneapolis, what we're doing here, something that they can take away with them if they're not from the Minneapolis area. What would that be? Okogyeamon?
That's difficult. The one thing of Minneapolis. I try to get my family from California to visit here. Especially in the wintertime, you can imagine what they're saying. They want to talk about how cold it is and how impossible it is. But I have nothing profound to say except that I find it a very beautiful place to live, very beautiful. So I love my California, I love my Seattle, Washington, Los Angeles and San Francisco and all of that, but this is a great place to live. I'm not saying there, you know, the racism here is significant. The diversity, it could be a lot better. Issues with the police are real issues, but still, it's a beautiful place to live.
20 seconds left? Okay. I'll just piggyback on a small portion of what you said, and I'll say this. It is warm in Minneapolis 3 months out the year. So come during those 3 months. You have a great time, see at least 5 of the 10,000 lakes, and maybe them all if you like.
Thank you. If you would like to join me giving them an applause, thank you so much.